Hello everyone and welcome to Vibu Systems' new webinar, Perfecting the Art of Unmasking the Hackers. Each month, join us for new powerful messages, technical tips and success stories that will leave you inspired and ready to get your protection, licensing and security techniques another step closer to perfection. Our hosts today are Rüdiger Kügler and Wolfgang Völker. Since 2003, Rüdiger has been working with Vibu Systems as a security expert. His core competencies include the protection of software against reverse engineering, the integration of licensing in the internal processes of software vendors, and the optimization of software and license distribution and management processes. He also contributed substantially to the development of Blurrybox, the encryption technology that took first place in the 5th German IT Security Prize. Through his extensive consulting activities, Wolfgang has acquired a deep knowledge in many programming languages and development environments such as C, C++, Java and C#. In his role as leader of the product management and support teams of Vibu Systems since 2002, his main focus is offering an ever-increasing professional and reliable experience with Codemeter. You may be familiar with spy movies, where devices self-destruct after delivering a message. In software protection, the destruction sequence starts when a trap is triggered. Typically, an end customer uses the software without realizing that traps are even present. A hacker instead will trigger them in his attempt to reverse engineer the software. Let's find out together how to make the hacker's mission impossible. A little housekeeping before we begin. This session is being recorded and a link to the replay will be posted directly to you in a couple of days. You are all muted, but you can post your questions in the live chat room. We will answer as many as we can at the end of the presentation. The floor is yours, guys. Let's get started.
Hello and a warm welcome from the speaker's lounge in the Vibu house. We have stopped rain outside and so we can now directly start with our webinar. And so our first we want to have a look at the agenda, what we want to look at today. So at first we want to show a little bit the hacking methods. What are the attackers doing? How do they try to get out the knowledge out of your application? So we will look at the dynamic reverse engineering and in contrast to the static reverse engineering. This will lead us to the concept of traps. We will show what traps are, what we define as a trap, and that this sends secret messages to the dongle to stop the dongle working for this license if someone meets the trap. And then we show how the traps are triggered. We will show this in two different live shows. At first with the integration in .NET applications. We will show how you can automatically protect your .NET application and use the traps in there, and additionally how to manually introduce traps into your source code. And for the other half of the world, the integration in native Windows applications, how to place the traps manually in your source code and how the locking then works. So let's start with the hacking methods.
Yeah, also welcome from me, Rüdiger Kügler here speaking, and let's talk about how hackers want to break your copy protection or want to get some intellectual property out from your software. And as Wolfgang mentioned, there are two different approaches. The first approach, we call this the dynamic hacking or dynamic reverse engineering, And the tools of this hacker or of these methods are debuggers. So mainly I'm debugging applications, so I'm executing the application and then I'm watching in the memory and finding out how the application works. So typical methods are setting breakpoints, patching some code in the memory, so overwriting a code and instead of a jump zero, replacing it by a jump not zero or no operation, something like this. Extracting some parts of the memory and dumping this to the hard drive and then trying to reconstruct and put all the stuff together. And typical tools which are used for this are OliDebug or MGD. MGD stands for multi-generic dumper, or Imprec, with which you can reconstruct and import a trace table after making such a dump. So the dynamic reverse engineering means executing the application and watching how it behaves. In contrary to this, we have static reverse engineering, which means I don't execute the application, so I'm disassembling it, so I'm using a disassembler like IDA Pro or Reflector or just Decompile. The first tool is a very generic tool which can nearly disassemble every type of code, and the Reflector and Just Decompile are two tools which especially were made to decompile a .NET application. There are a lot of other applications out there in the world, also for Java applications like JDI, GUI, and so on. So there are a lot of tools for disassembling, which means you take the executable, you take the DLL, the jar file, the assembly, and just run it through the disassembler, and then you get C-sharp code, Visual Basic, .NET code, or you get IL code, or you get assembler code in case of a native application. And then something like analyze the code or methods of the hacker, so finding out the flow structure of the program, and then patching also code there on the hard drive, and then try to execute the software. And so most of the hackers, of course, use both methods, so they combine this dynamic approach with the static approach. And I have just brought two samples, one sample with a .NET assembly, another sample with a real native Windows application. And for this, I'm going to the folder which I'm calling hack. And in this folder, let's start with the .NET application written in C#. This is a small command line application, simple sample API. And when I call this application and I have the fitting license, it works. It says, okay, I'm simple sample API, and please start me with option:1. And then it says, okay, I'm executing function 1. And if I say option 2, it executes function 1 and 2. So it's just a small sample application. And now I will remove the license. Unfortunately, you will not see that I removed the dongle, but Wolfgang could say, yes, I will do it. Yes, so here it is. So now it is removed, and now when I try to start the application, I got a message now, sorry, there is no license. So, and let's assume I'm the evil hacker, and what could I do? I would start a program like Just Decompile, for instance, and I already put this application via track and drop here, but let's start again from the beginning. I'm tracking, dropping the application here. And then what we see all the namespaces, all the functions. So trap sample is the namespace, and there is my class, there is a program. And so typically when I'm a hacker, I'm searching for some error messages, so for some strings like no license found, or I'm searching for exit process, for environment exit, application exit, and it's quite easy. I already found my no license checkbox. And let's go here, and now we don't need to decompile MS Corelib. And so we find here the code. If the access to code meter fails, then bring the error message, no license, and exit the application. And so it's quite easy to disassemble and analyze the code if it isn't encrypted. So a reason why you should encrypt your software. And by the way, if you're not familiar with C#, then you can, of course, switch it to Visual Basic and have this Visual Basic code style here. But the question is, what would a hacker do now to hack this application? And there are some really cool plugins. One of them is called Reflexil. And with Reflexil, I can see the IL code. And here we see I have the string no license, and due to the fact that as a hacker I want to have an evidence that I made this in the software, and that's why I'm changing this to Tiger Hack proudly presents, and update this, and then just removing the environment exit. So we don't need this. Delete this part of the code, delete this part of the code. So you see it's quite easy to patch an not really protected .NET application, so if it is unencrypted. The most difficult part here is to find the save button, because it's on the right mouse and here on save as. So this is the trick here to do this. And now on my hard drive I have a second application which is called Simple Sample Patched, and now let's execute my Simple Sample Patched, and now it works without any license. And what you see here in the first line is TigerHack proudly presents, so also our evidence that we made it, that I made it, is here now in our software. And that's a quite easy way to disassemble things in a .NET application. And if you say, but with a real Windows application, native application, it's not so easy. I have a small second sample, TigerPad Delphi. It's an old application, and if I try to start this, I get a message, sorry, no license not found. And so in this case, I would, due to the fact it's a native application, using IDA Pro. So I'm starting IDA Pro. Which is a great tool, by the way. Go work on your own. And then I'm just dragging and dropping the file here. So typically I would say just override and create new. I will load the existing one. I prepared this demonstration already due to the fact that IDA Pro needs a few minutes to analyze the whole application. And due to the fact I don't want to wait this minutes and to waste your time here, and that's why I already prepared this analysis. And what we see here now, I can also search for license not found. We are already at the right part here, and then I can say graphical view, and what we see here is a really nice representation that I see. Okay, here I have a function which is calling subfunction 457500, and then there is a test EL. So if the return value is 1, it should go this way, and if the return value is 0, then it should go to the license not found way. So it looks like we have found the fitting function, and this subfunction here, this looks like the very interesting function. Switch back to text view, and here I now jump to this very interesting function, and here we see there's a CM access, a CM release, and at the end there is some return value. And so maybe a good idea is to replace this whole function with a return true. And so this is what we could do here. And so typically I would, as I told you, most of the hackers are combining both methods. And so I would load the application into a debugger. My preferred way is OliDebug. This is a tool which was originally written for Windows XP, and so it has some issues on Windows 7, so maybe there are some error messages in the next things, but let's assume that under Windows XP it's a great tool, and it mostly works also under Windows 7. And we found out that the interesting part was at address 0x457500. Let's go to this part and let's set a breakpoint here, and now let's execute our application. So now we are here at this breakpoint, and just let's go to this function. Let's go to the function F8. We go to the next return value. Now we're in the CodeMeter functionality. I don't want it to go here, but okay, call, and so on. Here's the next return. So return to our functionality, to our function test exax. So here's one test, if this is one or not. Okay, this looks quite interesting. Let's step a little bit forward to the real return of the function. Here we have it, and set a breakpoint here. And I continue to go to the exit of the function. No, let's continue. So now we are at the exit of the function, and in the next step, we are back to the code we have already analyzed in our IDA Pro. And now we see, okay, there's a test if the return value of EAX or of register AL is 0 or 1. Now it is 0, so let's put it to 1. And now let's continue working and go on. So, and now our application starts. And that's all. So we need to find the right jump and to say, okay, here let's have a different return value. And of course, if I want to make a more generic hash crack, that's what I told you, that there are some minor issues with IDA, with Oli debug under Windows 7. But let's go again to this address. And as I told you, maybe it's a good idea to just say, hello, everything is fine. And so just double click here and move EAX1, because 1 is okay, and then return. So we're just patching this in our in the memory and then saying, okay, let's start the application. And now we don't need to set a breakpoint here. We can remove it. And now our application starts. Everything works fine. And by the way, if we go to the About dialog, we will also see that all functions, basic module activated, font module activated, because we found the one and only checking of the license, and we overwrote it with our own yes, everything okay code. And if I want to make a permanent crack, then I would of course patch it in the executable on the hard drive. So I would take an editor, UltraEdit, Notepad, something like this, and then I could just change it on the hard drive. And this was a short demonstration how hackers are using these quite easy and nice tools. And now let's continue with the question, what can we do against this, Wolfgang?
Yeah, to see what we can do against this, we should at first have a look how the AX Protector works. And so we will at first look at the AX Protector for native applications, and afterwards we will look at .NET applications, .NET assemblies, because this is really different because of the kind of the application. So if you have a native application, you have the compiled code afterwards, and as you have seen now in IDA Pro and so on, this is not very easy to read. You need some exercise on this, but it may be possible, but you don't have the real source for this. So in this case, also the pre-requirements are not very high, so the application starts if you start it, and so we can modify the code itself. So the AX Protector will now protect an executable, so let's have a look at the compiled application. You may know how this is assembled, so you have a header in an application, then you have the code section where you have most your complete code. Then you have the data section where the variables are stored and some other data. And in the resource section you have additional things like strings and so on. So if you protect this now with AX Protector, these sections are encrypted, as you can see on the right side, and then we have an encrypted code section and data and resource section, all encrypted. So this is really crumbled data. You don't see anything useful if you try to look at this with a tool, and you are normally aware how to read the binary code of an application. You will not really understand what you see, because this is really encrypted. So on starting the application starts, and the startup point is now in the AX engine that we also have attached to the application. And this AX engine then knows how to decrypt the code. So it checks the license and it will decrypt all the sections, and then the application again is available in the memory, and you can start with your part of the application after a short additional time for the startup phase. Of course, an hacker now wants to get a snapshot, a memory dump from this decrypted application, and therefore we have added several methods how to avoid this, how to make this very difficult. And so we are detecting tools that are doing memory dumps. We modify the import address table so that the starting points of the functions are not at the original point. And we also modify the code of the application in a way that jumps inside the application are no longer working if you try to cut off the AX engine after this has been decrypted. So also, if someone gets memory dump, if he has got the snapshot and cuts off the AX engine, it will not work because some pointers will point to the AX engine and it will not work without. So what we see is that we have the AX protector, which generates high security with very low effort. So within 5 minutes, you have protected your application. Additionally, you can add more security to your application if you use the AX protector. This will really increase security, but needs your interaction. You need to know a little bit about your application, and you need to know what you want to additionally protect with AX protector. So in this case, we protect additional some functions that you have to define. So some of your functions where you are doing interesting things, you have to define in the source code. We will see later on. And then before the AX protector is encrypting the complete sections, the functions itself are encrypted. And afterwards, the AX protector encrypts the complete application. So in the consequence, if we start the application, we decrypt the sections, but the functions are already encrypted, the functions that have you defined to be protected additionally. If you now want to use this encrypted function, there you have really looking like garbage code in the memory. And before you can call this function, you need to decrypt this, or you need to trigger the decryption of this function, which is done by an API call we will see in the next demo. So you call the function to decrypt the function, and then you can call the function itself. And afterwards, if you have finished working with your function, then you can also encrypt it again so that it is not playing in the memory for a very long time. And especially, you should take care that not all the functions are decrypted in the memory. In such phases of the application, it would be possible to have a memory dump where also all the functions are decrypted. So if you use now AX Protector, you have very high security against dynamic code analysis, and we now can additionally add some traps to increase the security one more time, especially against the static reverse engineering.
Where are the traps? I don't see traps here, Wolfgang.
Yeah, that's the same as to me if I show this slide. So you see six times encrypted functions. No, if you look exactly, then you see that the third and the fifth are not encrypted functions. These are encrypted traps. So, but this is exactly how it looks to the attacker, to the hacker. Yeah, he just after the application has started and the sections have been decrypted, he sees six functions that are encrypted. So he sees some garbage code code he cannot understand because this is encrypted. But the difference is not all of these functions can be decrypted without problems. Yeah, you can. So if you try then to get all the entry points for this function, say, okay, I now decrypt all of them, then you will also get the traps. And in case that you want to decrypt a trap, then the decryption sequence that is sent to the dongle looks exactly like the sequences for real encrypted functions, but the dongle now knows that this is called by a trap, and then he will lock the dongle, especially your firm code, without any chance not to do this. So you need to pass this sequence to the dongle. You don't see that this is some code that will lock your dongle. So of course you need to do something that these functions that are never called from the application itself are not thrown away by compiler or linkers. So you need to call them. You should have some calls like this if call, if income tax is higher than 100%. So that's nothing that really happens, but this does not the compiler or linker know. But in reality, this could not be the case. So with such a statement, you can insert the call of a trap in your code. And it will not be optimized by a linker. Otherwise, if you have something written, inserted like if false, it will never be called and will optimized by the linker, and so your trap will be gone before you have entered it. So if the hacker wants to get an idea which of the encrypted parts are functions, real functions, and which of them are traps, then he needs really expert knowledge about your application and how to walk through the application. Then of course he will walk around the traps and not meet them, but this normally is not the case, because in such cases the hacker could have written the application by himself. Okay, this has been for native applications, how it works there for Delphi, C++, Fortran, yes, also Fortran, you may know it from former times. And we will now have a short look to the axprotector.net, because for .NET assembly, we work completely different. A .NET assembly is compiled to an intermediate language, and this intermediate language covers all the source code parts, nearly all the source code parts, so the variable names are really there and you can see them in the application if you disassemble this. And so we also need to create after the protection an assembly that is a real .NET assembly that passes all the checks of the .NET framework if this is a valid application. And so we cannot just crumble the data somewhere, because the .NET framework would claim that this is not real and valid .NET code. So what are we doing there? If you have a function in your .NET assembly, we cut out of the function, of the method, all the code that you are doing inside. We take this code out of there, we encrypt it using functionality of CodeMeter, and then we store this encrypted code in the data section. So for .NET, this is only some data, so and data can be whatever, so no problem with any check. And for each method you have just the remaining code, so the starting point of the method and the end point of the method, and in between you see only one call to the AX engine. So what we can say is that an AX protector for .NET is an automatic AX protector of all the methods that you have in your .NET assembly. So what we're doing there, we are get all the stuff out of the methods and we put it encrypted into the data section. So afterwards we have the encrypted parts, and in the so-called stub code we only have this nearly empty functions where you don't have your intellectual property inside. And this is really a good way against the hackers, so they cannot get the real contents of the application. And this is, we now could add some traps for protection against also the different types of analysis. And this is then can also be done automatically. So we don't need to do this by hand. We can do this automatically. Just set an option minus trap, and then with a chance of 10%, we create for a function, we create additionally a trap function. And so this function will look like the original function. It looks like an overloaded method of the original method. So we may exchange the arguments, or add an argument, or remove an argument, whatever. So we do it in a combination that you're not using within your application. So since we are now at .NET, let's have a look how the integration really works in .NET, Rüdiger.
Okay, so I also prepared a small sample how to integrate our traps into a .NET application. Okay, so let's go to our .NET application that I prepared here, traps sample. I made a small demonstration application. Let's go to the source code. And I have here a class which is called my class, which is the my intellectual property. And this has three major functions, which are called function 1, function 2, and function 3, and which are just saying, hello, I'm function 1, I'm function 2, and I'm function 3. And when I start my application, it says I'm function 1 or 2, or if I'm starting this on a command line, let's go here, release cmd, and I will start my traps sample with started here, and then say minus option colon and 3, and then I get a message function 3 and function 2. So depending on the value that I'm entering, it does something internally. So and now I want to protect my application. And the first step, as Wolfgang already told you, the first step is to protect it with AX Protector, and then to implement the traps by using AX Protector. So I'm starting AX Protector, and I say I want to protect the .NET assembly, I think. Yes, .NET assembly. Yeah. Of course, AX Protector is also available in English. It's not only available in German. So what do? I will drag and drop the source file, which I want to protect. And it says, okay, I will create a subfolder protected, and the protected application should be placed there. In the next step on licensing system, I'm choosing if I want to use a dongle or a software license. By the way, of course, for this, traps and locking of dongles, the dongle are more stronger because the dongle is really locked. And a soft license is also locked, but the locking is just a flag hidden and a secured flag somewhere on the hard drive, so it's not quite easy to revert it. But of course, the locking of a dongle is more stronger. And to use this, I need to use a real firm code 100,002, which is, by the way, my firm code. And the rest is then fine, okay, license handling, runtime settings, security options. And here, this is the important part, automatic trap generation, yes or no. We will say, yes, we will do this. And Wolfgang told us there's a 10% probability that a function will get a trap function. And so if you have three functions, and maybe we get one, maybe we get two, maybe we get no trap function, but we will see this. We will take a look with some hacking tools, and I will show you how to avoid this. So if you have an application with only a few functions, how to make sure that you really create more traps than it does automatically. Error messages, also okay. Strom name, advanced options, that's also fine. And here when I go to IX Protector, it tries to
send us an error.
And it does not work any longer. The reason for this is now I has fallen into a trap. Because if you remember, in the beginning I showed you some hacking tools and how this hacking tools works, and AX Protector, by the way, is using AX Protector for protection. And so we have some traps and some detection mechanism implemented in our software, and they have found out, oh, there are some evil tools like IDA Pro, or I think OliDebug. I don't know which of the two it was, maybe they are both.
Maybe one was the first and the other one would have been the second.
So and, to overcome this, what would I do? I would need to call the vendor of AX Protector. Dear Wolfgang, could you please reactivate my dongle? And due to the fact that this was a prepared demonstration, I have a second dongle and I need to exchange the dongle. So, and now continue without scanning because I have removed this dongle without just plugging it out, just hard remove. And it tells me that this wasn't fine for him, but now we see everything works fine. We have closed all the evil tools and now everything still works fine again. So and what we see here, we see all our classes, namespaces and functions. And one thing I want to show you here is that we have the three functions that we want to protect, function 1, 2 and 3. And all three functions are 11 bytes because due to performance reasons, there is threshold which says functions which are less than 10 bytes should not be encrypted because majorly they don't include intellectual property and so they are not really important, but maybe they will slow down the performance of the application, and that's why we say small functions should not be encrypted. And so I just want to show you, yes, these functions, they are encrypted. Okay, summary, and now go on, finish this, and when we finish the encryption, then we will see we have a now protected application, and with a probability of 10%, these functions are now trap functions, and so we will start now, Telerik just decompile, and I will track and drop my protected application to Telerik. I will remove this, we don't need this any longer. And let's find our traps sample, my class. And I'm keen to see it. No, the probability was against us. And so the functions are not duplicated as trap functions. But as I told you, if you have a very small application, then we can overcome this and we can say, okay, we just deactivate this automatic trap generation here. And we say minus trap 1 and 100%. So the probability to create a trap should be 100%. And so every function will now create a trap function. And now we encrypt it again. And when we check again, fast restarting Telerik. And now we see that it was reloaded. And when we take a look here, now we see what Wolfgang has explained. Function 1, the original one, function 1 now with a signature of a string. Function 2, the original one, function 3, and function 3, the original one. So of course, for me as the developer of the software, I know which functions are the right one, the one without any parameters, but the one with the parameters are the wrong one. But let's assume you're a hacker, and as a hacker, you could not find out, distinguish between a trap function and a real function that is used. So now if I would create some tools which just decrypt all function one by one, it would decrypt me the first function, it would also decrypt the second function, but then it would lock or this function one with the string, and then it would lock itself, so the license would be locked, and I can no longer use the dongle, and so I have no chance to decrypt all the other functions. And this is the easy way to implement traps. Just say, yes, I'm using traps, or if you have a Hello World application, say minus trap one and 100%.
Okay, but do we have also a chance to do some more special trap to have additional functions? Can I do it also by hand?
Yes, of course. So let's assume we have a function that we call function 4. Let's just copy function 3 to make it easier. Function 3, and say this should now be function 4. And we don't call it function 4. We will call this you will never see this, because this sentence would be replaced by our trap code, and then it will no longer be executed. And so when I want to say this function should be my trap function, then I need to add as reference WP.NET and WP-EngineNet, so the two libraries of Vibu. And then all I need to do is to say this is WP-Engine.protection and this is a WP-Engine trap level dot trap one. And that's it. And so now the function is marked with the attribute this function should be a trap. I will compile the application now. Okay, it's compiled, everything is fine. I will now run axprotector and protect it once again, protect now. And after doing the protection, we can now see that we have function 4. And no one could distinguish if this is a real function or a trap function. Now let's just start Telerik for the last time here. And say traps, trap sample, my class. And now we have the overloaded versions of our original functions, and we have our manually created function 4, which is also a trap.
So Rüdiger, why I don't see on the right side the contents of also of the functions? So also, yeah, what is there on the right side? I only see exceptions. Is this normal?
This is not normal. This is due to the fact that we have some security options which saying reflector defense. The name reflector defense is because the first tool which does this disassembling, the first really public and common and great tool, was reflector, and that's why we put some things in our application, in the protected application, that these decompiler tools could not translate it back to C# or Visual Basic Code. They can only compile it back to intermediate code, because there are some code which they could not understand, and so it's a bit more harder. And if you take a look into this function 2, then we no longer see something like console write line function 2. We only see some calls which are, by the way, obfuscated of axprotector.net, so of our AX engine. And then we see somewhere this A1, which is calling of your original function. And so this is the stub code which checks if everything is okay, and then decrypts your function, and then calls the AX engine. And so instead of your code, now we have this AX protector code, and your code is really encrypted and can no longer be seen in tools like decompile or like reflector. Yeah, and this was a short demonstration how to implement traps into .NET. So we see it's quite easy, either saying, yes, I want to do this automatically, or you can do this manually. And what we see here, we can have both manually included traps and automatically included traps. If you don't want to have this automatically created with trap 0, you can say the probability is 0, and so you will only use the manually created traps. And so it's under your full control.
Okay, that's great. And so we now have seen how to do this with .NET. It's quite easy to add automatic traps, and also really easy to make some manual traps. Let's now have a look how this works with native Windows applications, because with native Windows applications we cannot do this in an automatic way. We need to do it manually all the time, or?
Yes, we need to do this a bit more manually, but it's also no rocket science. And so let's take a look here. I also prepared a small function, which is, by the way, very similar. I have three functions, function 1, function 2, and function 3. And when I want to protect this with iXProtector, so the first step is AXProtector, then iXProtector. AXProtector just encrypting it, and iXProtector means I need to include vibu xup.h. And as we told you, we want to encrypt these functions, and so we need to make sure that we can find them, and that's why we need to export them. And so we could do something like DLL export, but the recommended way is not to write it manually. The recommended way is to write wupi decl func, because this is a macro created by us, which includes two things, which makes sure that the function is exported, so it's in the export table, because then we can find it, and it makes sure that the function will not be optimized inline, so that there should be no duplicate created by the compiler. And so you say, ah, the function is protected, but the function was duplicated, and only one of the two occurrences is encrypted, and the other one is not encrypted, which might be not quite good. And as Wolfgang also already mentioned, the functions are not decrypted automatically. So now we have said, okay, these functions should be encrypted, and now we should make sure that the functions are decrypted before calling them, and that's why we will call our wupi function if wupi decrypt code from 1, if this equals, so if everything is okay, wupi decrypt code. Now it's better. So if you write it right, everything is okay. So we decrypt the code, then we use the function with this code, and then we call wupi encrypt code from 1 again, and that's it. And of course we need to do this with the other two functions too. I will do this once, second time, and the third time, because it's three times here, and we need to have the closing also after everything is done. Fine, okay, and now we make,
yeah, well, you don't need to do the encryption of the function every time you have used it, but maybe you are doing some calculation where you use such a function very often, and then you will do the decryption before, then you will use it 1,000 times, and afterwards you can decrypt it, for example, if you leave the area where you're working with this function. Of course, the functionality of or calling an encryption again of the code and the decryption itself needs some time, not a long time, but it needs some time, and so if you would do it every time on the 1,000 steps, then you would lose some time that will not really help to irritate the hacker. So yeah, in the meantime, have copied some DLL I've seen.
Yes, because if you want to start your application, the unprotected, unencrypted application now needs a special DLL. Our wupi engine 32 or 64 depends on the architecture of the processor DLL, and this is a dummy DLL. So this one says if you, because the code is now not encrypted, and so the DLL is called, and as long as your application is not protected, the DLL says, hey, everything is fine, I just decrypted the code, you can run the code, and so for debugging and testing, just put the DLL into the same directory, and then you can execute your application. So, and now let's encrypt the application.
Well, during the encryption of the application, The reference to this WPI engine DLL is removed and replaced by pointers to the AX engine that is appended to the executable. This WPI engine DLL is only necessary during development, and you should not distribute or deploy it, and you don't need it afterwards. It's automatically included.
So the first steps are similar for AX Protector and AX Protector.net, and now with AX Protector we just say we add function with the name function 1. This should be encrypted, everything is fine. Add also function 2, it's also fine, and add function 3. And that's it. And by the way, if you have seen, if you have asked yourself, why does I call decrypt code 1, decrypt code 2, and how is the reference of the 1 and the 2 to function 1 and 2 and so on? And here's the solution to this riddle. You have your IDs, the IDs for the WPI function calls, decrypt function 1, 2 and 3, and here we connect them to the exported name function 1, function 2 and function 3. And so this is the mystic behind this WPI decrypt by number. And now I'm encrypting the executable. Now everything works fine because I have closed all these hacking tools, as you have seen. And now we have our AX Protector and IX Protector, and now we want to implement some traps. And the implementation of the trap, by the way, we see also here that the functions are now encrypted, everything is fine. And the implementation of the trap now is quite simple, because what we do is we will just have one more function, and let's call this trap one, and here we write again, you will never see this. So, and this is this from the from your code. Okay, and now let's say I will compile the code again. Okay, everything is fine. And now I go back to AX Protector, and what I do here is I go to the IX Protector page. I say, okay, I have a function which is called trap1, and this one is a trap. And so that's all. I just say this function is a trap function. Please encrypt this function as a trap. Finish, and that's it. So now I have implemented some trap functions, and now if a hacker would remove AX Protector, which is very hard, and if a hacker then tries to find all the encrypted parts of the application and tries to decrypt them one by one, as soon as he reaches this function, he will lock his dongle and he could no longer use the dongle, if, and really if, he is able to get onto this point. And this is how to implement traps in your software. One interesting thing is maybe we could simulate how to fall into such a trap. Let's first check if the software is still working. So I have to protect the software, and I'm using this traps sample executable, and I got a message, there is no license for this because I need to plug in the right dongle. The dongle, by the way, I have removed for the first demonstration, for the first cracking demonstration. So now when I execute my function, it says function 1. If I execute with 2, it says function 2, and so on. And so it works like it should do. And of course, if this is a small application, it's quite easy for the hacker to start it 3 times if he knows that with 1, 2, 3, the 3 different functions are called. But let's assume it's a complex application which has a graphical interface, which has a lot of functionalities inside, then it's not quite easy to find or to execute all the codes. And that's why a hacker tries to find all the functions and tries to do this manually. And if he does this, this means he needs to decrypt the function. And so the hacker would try to inject some code which should look like, at the beginning of the software, decrypt code 1, decrypt code 2, 3, four, five. So a hacker would like to have a type of code here, and so he would try to inject some part of code. Of course, I don't want to show how a hacker could do this with a compiled application, and that's why I will implement this into my sample. So just for simulating this. So, and now let's encrypt the application once again, one last time. We also see here, this one is a trap, this one is a function, function, a function, and now it's encrypting. By the way, why does it take so long to encrypt this application, Wolfgang?
Yeah, this is because of the different variants that of key pairs that we are creating during the encryption. And so there are several keys that are used in a part randomly, but also depending on some variables that are coming, for example, from the computer where the application is executed. So we don't use the same keys all the time, and so for this is against some attacks that want to get out the keys and always use some variant of this, and this might work on one system, but on another system this hack would not work. So this is only slow on the encryption of the application. This does not influence the decryption, the startup time of the application. There we only use one key at a time, and so this is fast.
Okay, so now let's start our application, and if I made everything right, then it should bring an error, and we see that it has not done so much. And if we now try to start it again, we get a new error, and now the error is called error 38. And everyone who is familiar with CodeMeter knows 38 means now the dongle is locked. And so with executing this hack, so with trying to decrypt all the functions which we did in the simulation, we could start our application once. We got an error message during the decryption of the strap, and now we can no longer start our application because now the application or the dongle is locked. Now I need to call the vendor. Dear Wolfgang, could you please reactivate the key? Or maybe I got a second one like I did before for this AX Protector demonstration. But yeah, in this case, I need to call the ISP and say, oh, please, I want to have a new key because I did some evil things, or no, I did nothing, and the key does no work any longer overnight. It just happened.
Yes. Well, and how does this locking really work? So we can read here that the firm access count is zero. So that is done by sending this sequence to the dongle that implicitly locks it. It decrements, or it sets the firm access counter to zero, and if the firm access counter is zero, you cannot use anymore this firm code until this has been reset to one or another value. And this can be done only by someone that has the firm security box. So the user that has run into such trouble needs to call you and ask you for the reprogramming. But you can do this on your own, and keep in mind you can do this only with your real firm code. It does not work with testing firm codes. So now we have seen how this has works with native applications, and here we see again the not really good seeable traps in between the real functions. Hopefully you have learned a little bit about inserting traps to your application and how to work with your application, how to increase the security by inserting some trap. So we are now at the end. We will now have a look to the chat if there are some questions. Yes, there are some questions. Yeah, one is about the exported function. Rüdiger, you said in your demonstration that if you call this WPDeckelfunk, the application is or this function is not optimized and not optimized to inline code, but you also said it is exported. Well, if it is exported, everyone can see it. Why?
Okay, so the export or the DeckelSpec DLL export is of course done in the unprotected application. So if you look with tools like Dependency Walker, then you will see that we have these four exported functions. And what you also see here is that we end not only function one, and it has some decorations here, and that's why we are looking for a substring. And so we're only looking if the substring function one is included in one of the exported functions. So don't use function and function one or test and test one, use test one and test two. Okay, but we see in the unprotected application they are exported, but now let's close this and let's take a look into the protected application, and then we will see that we of course remove them from the export table, and so they are no longer in the export table and so can no longer be seen by a hacker.
Well, and how should I protect a function that is really called from external?
So you mean an exported function in a DLL? Of course, if you want to execute an exported function in a DLL, you need to make a small wrapper function around. So like this dubcode in our.NET, and so you need to move the functionality into a my function internal. And in my function, you need to call WPDecryptCode decrypt code, and if WPDecryptCode decrypt code, then call my function internal. And if this WPDecryptCode decrypt code failed, then the license is not there, and then you need to have an error handling and bring an error message to the calling host application, depending on your interface between the host and your DLL. And so you need to move the real functionality into an internal function and keep the or the really exported function unprotected, only with calling this WP encrypt code, WP decrypt code. And so in the beginning, you export both internal and external, and only external remains exported after the decryption because we don't remove the export table, we only remove the entries with our functions, with the protected functions.
Okay, I think that's clear now. Well, the last question that is open from the chat now is, what is about the antivirus programs? Do they don't bother about this crumbled data? Do they classify the protected applications as a potential virus?
So of course, this is some behavior, or this is behavior which is also used by viruses. So encrypting some code dynamically or decrypting this code dynamically in the memory. And so of course, an antivirus program would say, oh, this is strange and this is maybe a virus. And therefore, we work strongly together with them to have us on whitelists, and we are one of the three top vendors for copy protection, and so the antivirus vendors know us, we speak together, we find together solutions so that they have whitelisting with our technology. And one very strong recommendation of us is use AuthentiCode. So AuthentiCode is a way to sign your application that the user can check, yes, this application really comes from software vendor A. And if this application is signed with such an AuthentiCode signature, then antivirus programs can also check, oh, the signature is valid, it comes from a real vendor, it's not on the blacklist, it's not on some revocation list, and then you get some bonus points, and this will help you very much to avoid that an encrypted application is on a blacklist. And so the using AuthentiCode for a signature is a very good idea together with AX Protector. And of course, we make sure that AX Protector is compatible with AuthentiCode. And so first use AX Protector and then use AuthentiCode, and then everything works well together.
Okay, there's no additional question. So I think we are at the end, and so we want to thank you for your patience, for your attention, and we hope you enjoyed our webinar, and you will, we will see and hear us again at the next webinar.
Hope to hear and see you soon. Have a nice day, a nice morning, a nice evening all over the world. Bye-bye.